Have your Bibles. I invite you once again to open to Luke's Gospel as we are doing a study through Luke's Gospel for our guests. And we are in chapter number 13. And as we do, we just kind of pick up where we left off last week. And today we're going to be in chapter 13. In a moment, we're going to begin looking at verse number 22 of Luke's Gospel, chapter number 13. You know, invitations are wonderful things. I always enjoy getting invitations, especially if it's an invitation to one of my favorite restaurants or something like that. I always enjoy that. But the most wonderful invitation that has ever been given is the invitation to follow Jesus. After every service on Sunday, I always extend an invitation for people to follow Jesus. I wonder, though, if the Lord Jesus could actually physically stand behind this pulpit and pulpits across our land and across our world. I wonder if Jesus extended an invitation to follow Him. I wonder if it would be like the invitations that we hear today that are given to people to follow Jesus. I wonder if the description of the Christian life that Jesus gives us in the New Testament, I wonder if that is the kind of description that we hear about today when it talks about the Christian life. I heard a pastor one time tell a story, a true story, of when he was given the opportunity and invited to speak at Cambridge, Massachusetts for a conference that was being held for ministers really around the world. Wasn't Cambridge University, which is in England, but Cambridge, Massachusetts, that is where Harvard University is located. Of course, one of the very bastions of liberal, social liberal, and theological liberal thought. And it was in that area where this conference was being held. He noticed as he was walking around the property where he was staying and where the conference was to be held, he noticed that there was a little restaurant that was located just outside of the gates of Harvard. And he said, "You know what? I think I'll get up early in the morning and I'll go down to that restaurant. I'll have a cup of coffee and put the finishing touches on the message that I'm going to preach." And so he got up early that morning, went down, and he was having his coffee and putting the finishing touches on his message. And when he did, he looked across the aisle there, and he saw this young Asian girl that was seated at a table, and she was reading what appeared to be a Bible. And so when he finished his preparation, he looked over and he noticed that, sure enough, she was actually studying the Scripture. So he walked over to where she was and he said to her, he said, "I've noticed that you are reading a Bible. Are you a Christian?" And her reply was absolutely classic. She said to the preacher, "Yes, I have found the narrow way." That is how she described being a follower of Christ. "I have found the narrow way." The preacher said, "I'd never heard of anybody describing the Christian life like that. And frankly, I've never heard of anybody describing it like that." He learned that she was from North Korea and she was the only member of her family that was a believer. And so just think about it. Here she was, 10,000 miles away from home, away from her Buddhist household with their 3 million gods, the very antithesis of the narrow way that she said she had found. Here she was in the very midst of Harvard's aggressive pluralistic thought, where they are tolerant of everything but the narrowness of the gospel, and she described responding to the invitation of Jesus as responding to the narrow way. And I really believe that here is a kingdom truth that we need to talk about today and we need to understand today to make sure that when we are extending invitations to people to follow Jesus, that we are extending the same invitation that Jesus did. So let's talk a little bit today about the invitation of Jesus. In Luke chapter 13, verse 22, the Bible says, "And he," that is Jesus, "he went through the cities and the villages teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. Then one said to him, Lord, are there few who are saved? And he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow gate. For many, I say to you, they will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open for us. And he will answer and say to you, I do not know you, where you are from. And then you will begin to say, we ate and we drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I do not know you, where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity. And there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God and yourselves thrust out. And they will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and they will sit down in the kingdom of God. And indeed, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last. Now, the first thing that we see out of this text is what I'm simply going to refer to as a pointed question down in verses 22 and 23. And the question that was posed here by this unnamed bystander as Jesus was walking along the road and he was teaching, well, this posed question did not get the answer that was anticipated. You see, the general understanding of all the Jews in that day was that all of the Jews, except for the very worst of the worst, that they were going to be saved. And so when the question was asked, they were expecting Jesus to affirm them in that belief. And they believed that, you know, all Jews except those that had committed very grievous sins, they were going to make it into the kingdom of God, or we might say they were going to make it through the pearly gates, they were going to make it into heaven. And they also believed, the Jews, that all of the Gentiles were going to be excluded from the kingdom of God, except for maybe a few proselytes along the way. And so the question that was asked then was a question that was intended to solidify the Jewish feelings of religious superiority, because they were, as they said, children of Abraham. Now, Jesus was about to give them an answer that was going to rock their world, because they were not prepared to receive the answer to this question, are few being saved? They weren't prepared to receive the answer that Jesus was about to give. I think we see in this first idea, we see a couple of very interesting things. First of all, we see the focus of Jesus. What was his focus? Well, verse 22 says that he went through the cities and the villages doing what? He was teaching. And so if the church today is going to follow the example of Jesus, then obviously the church will be a teaching institution. So as he was on his way to Jerusalem, the Bible says his face was set like a flint to get there, because that's where he was going to be crucified and die for the sins of the world. And as he was on his way there, the Bible says that he was teaching. You see, all that Jesus did, all of the miracles that he performed, all of the signs and the wonders that he displayed, those were not simply additional ministries added on to his teaching. In fact, all of the miracles and all of the signs and wonders that he displayed, that was simply a validation of his teaching. And we ask the question, well, what did Jesus teach? Jesus taught truth. You see, Jesus understood something that you and I must understand today, and that is that truth is foundational to all living. Take truth away and you have no life. I'm talking about God's truth. I'm talking about biblical truth. I'm talking about the truth that the Lord Jesus Christ taught. And so Jesus made a big deal then out of his teaching ministry. But what is so interesting to me is what the content was given the context of this particular passage. What was the content of the teaching of Jesus? Yes, he was walking along the roadside. He was going through villages. He was teaching. But the question is, what was the content of that teaching in that context? Well, I believe we can figure out very easily when we begin to look at this question, why did they ask the question? Lord, are few being saved? Well, obviously, it is because Jesus was teaching about salvation. You see, dear friends, that tells us something very important. It tells us that if truth is the foundation for life, then it tells us that the truth about salvation is the foundation for truth. And so if we get that point wrong, we'll get everything else wrong. I mean, the first place that we got to start is to make sure that we have a proper understanding about salvation. The most important truth about salvation is, what is salvation? I mean, can we adequately give an invitation to anybody to follow Jesus if we do not have an accurate understanding of what salvation truly is? What is salvation? The word salvation is a word that literally means deliverance. But the question is, deliverance from what? It is not simply a deliverance from an unhappy life or an unfulfilled life. That's not salvation. Now, when we get saved, obviously salvation gives us fulfillment in life. It's not deliverance from an unhappy marriage or, you know, financial problems. Now, when you and I get saved, we get in tune with God so that now we have the wisdom to make decisions in our marriage, our home life, our finances, and everything else. But friend, that's not salvation. And friends, sometimes we hear the invitation, you need to get saved. Why? Because you need to fix your marriage. Or you need to, you know, find fulfillment in life or whatever. But friend, now listen, I don't want to blow your mind now, but I just want to tell you the truth. What is salvation? Salvation is a deliverance from the wrath of God against our sin. That's salvation. Friend, I'm not making this stuff up. Romans chapter 5, verse 6, for when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man some would even dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him. What is salvation? It is a deliverance from the wrath of God against our sin. And so the question then that they asked Jesus, are only a few being saved? In reality, what they were asking was, are only a few being delivered from the divine judgment of God? Friend, inviting people to follow Jesus without including that teaching is excluding the very reason people need to be saved. We can't be saved until we understand what we need to be saved from. We need to be saved from the wrath of God against our sin. And so did you know that if we give the invitation to someone, come to Jesus because God loves you, and we stop it right there, then we have given an incomplete invitation. The invitation is, yes, come to Jesus because God loves you, and He loves you so much that He wants you to be delivered through Jesus from the wrath of God against sin, because Jesus died for our sins on the cross to deliver us from the wrath of God against that sin for which Jesus died. So we see then the focus of Jesus, it was teaching, and it was teaching the truth about salvation. But we also see the fruit of Jesus. Now, when you understand this passage in its context, you understand that Jesus is nearing the conclusion of His earthly ministry. He is about to the end of that 3.5-year period in which He walked on this planet, and what we find out is that as He was getting toward the end of His ministry, how little fruit there was to actually show. I mean, you think about it. Every miracle that He performed, I mean, he always spoke absolute truth. He lived a sinless and a peerless life before those that were looking at him. But there was very little fruit from the ministry of the Lord Jesus during those days. As a matter of fact, that fruit was so small that back in Luke chapter 12, a chapter we've already looked at, verse number 32, he referred to his followers as what? A little flock. I want to tell you, had Jesus been a Baptist preacher, he'd have been fired because of the lack of baptisms. There was such little fruit in the ministry of the life of the Lord Jesus as he went about preaching and he went about teaching. Now, there were large numbers that followed him when he was offering them miracle food. I mean, everybody came to him. They were attracted to him. But then he began to hit them up with some hard sayings like, if you're going to follow me, you got to deny yourself. You got to take up your cross. And dear friends, when Jesus did that, all of a sudden the crowd began to thin out. In other words, a true presentation of the gospel many times does not get a favorable response. You remember back in the parable of the sower, the four soils represent human hearts. How many of those four soils received the seed and bore fruit? One-fourth. One-fourth. Only one-fourth of the soil received it. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that let's not get duped into believing that, man, you know, there's going to be this massive response to the gospel in this life, in this age. That's just not what the Bible teaches. So the second thing that we see a posed question, we see a perplexing answer down in verse number 24. Notice this perplexing answer. Jesus said, strive to enter in through the narrow gate. For many, I say to you, they will seek to enter and they will not be able to enter. I call this a perplexing answer because Jesus didn't answer them directly. What Jesus was saying was, listen, rather than you worrying about the few, you need to worry about you. You need to worry about you, that you are one of the ones being saved. I remember one time Karen and I were in a home and we were sharing the gospel with this guy. And I was going over the gospel with him and what he needed to do to be saved. And you could tell he was very nervous. And so he tried to divert the attention from himself. And he asked me the question. He said, well, preacher, what about all the heathen out in the jungle who have never even heard of the name Jesus? Somehow I think had Jesus been there, he might have said, stop worrying about the heathen in the jungle and start worrying about the one in this living room. You know, stop worrying about the few and make sure that you are one of the ones that's being saved. I think it's a perplexing answer also because this almost seems like heresy. When we compare it to some of the invitations that we hear today for people to follow Jesus, this almost sounds like a heretical statement. Jesus said, listen, the door's narrow. Few are going to come through that door. Many aren't going to make it. And it sounds almost like heresy compared to the ways that we in the evangelical world today invite people to follow Christ. If you want to be saved, raise your hand. If you want to be saved, repeat this prayer after me. Now, friend, there's nothing wrong with raising a hand or praying a prayer if we don't stop there. But we've got to go on with a gospel presentation if we are going to invite people to come to Jesus like Jesus invited them to come to him. I think it is also perplexing because in verse number 24, Jesus said, now, Pastor Connor's not making this stuff up. Jesus said, for many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able. He didn't say some. He said, many. There are many that are on the broad road. There are few, he says, that are on the narrow road. And friend, in this perplexing answer, there are two tremendously important things that we see. Number one is we see the way of salvation. This is the way of salvation. Now, friend, since this is what Jesus taught, this is right. This is right. Because he has all authority, right, in heaven and in earth. And his teaching on this here is the right teaching. So what do we see? We see that the way of salvation is a serious way. He said down in verse number 24 that we are to strive to enter in through the narrow gate. The word strive there, that's where I get this idea of seriousness. We're to be serious about this. It's talking about something, listen, that we go after with all of our heart. It's something that we almost pursue with a reckless abandon. It is a goal that we see that is out there, and we expend great effort and great energy in going after that goal. What he was saying was, listen, the most serious thing you could ever do in life is to make sure that you are one of the ones that's coming through the narrow door of salvation. Friend, why should we be so serious about it? I tell you, in light of what is at stake, what's at stake, heaven or hell? And in light of the finality of eternity, it is forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Then we need to make sure that we have come through the narrow door. You see, the Jews, just like I'm afraid some of us sometimes, they presumed that they were getting into the kingdom because of their privileged position. We are children of Abraham. We are a part of the covenant people. And because of that privileged status, we are going to be okay. And it's almost like Jesus was saying, listen, don't you be duped and miss heaven because you are basing your eternal security on your privileged position. And what he's saying to us is, listen, don't do the same thing. Think about your soul with all earnestness and seriousness. Think about it. Don't be duped into thinking that because you're an American or you're a Baptist or you're a member of the First Baptist Church of Panama City. Listen, assess your life in the light of Scripture and make sure that you have entered this narrow door of salvation that the Lord Jesus Christ is talking about. Well, Pastor, are you saying we're saved by our effort? No, I'm not saying we're saved by our effort. But that word strive, there is the Greek word agonizomai, which means to agonize. It's something we ought to agonize over. No, we're not saved by our effort. We are saved by God's grace. We are saved by Jesus. My friend, I'm going to tell you what he is trying to get across to us here is that we cannot be saved. Now listen, we are saved by the sovereign grace of God. Only way we can be saved. But friend, we cannot exclude our will that's involved in that. Because both John the Baptist, Jesus, and the apostles, they all taught that to be saved we had to repent. And repentance is an act of the will. It is a choice. We have to choose with our will to go through the narrow door of salvation that God offers after he convicts us of our sin. And I want to tell you, it requires some effort because Satan will make sure he puts up obstacles in front of that narrow door. He'll put up the obstacle of our pride, so we have to humble ourselves and admit before God our need to be saved, our need of his grace. He will place before that door that the Lord places before us, that narrow door, a love of sin that the flesh just doesn't want to get rid of. That's where repentance comes in. And friend, let me tell you the good news. After we enter the narrow door of salvation, then we begin to progressively conquer the love for sin through our exposure to the Bible and our discipleship And our love for Jesus will replace our love for sin once we come through that narrow door. I tell you what else he'll do. He'll throw before us that opposition of peer pressure. Well, what will everybody think if I follow Jesus? I come through this narrow door and I start walking on the narrow way. What will all of my unsaved friends, what will they think? But friend, if we do like Jesus is teaching here, we'll adopt the attitude, I don't care what anybody says, I don't care what anybody thinks, I'm going to make sure I have entered into that narrow door. I'm going to do that. I'm going to be desperate for that. See, that's what I don't see that's grieving my heart today. I don't see this desperation of people wanting to be saved and knowing that they are saved. Where is this desperation that Jesus talked about? Like blind Bartimaeus in Mark 10 sitting by the side of the road begging. And the Bible says that Jesus was coming along and he'd heard about Jesus, how he healed blind people. And old Bartimaeus, when he heard that Jesus was passing by, the Bible says that he stood up and he cried out, "Lord, have mercy on me." And the crowd said, "Hush down. Be quiet, Bartimaeus. You're embarrassing us." And the Bible said Bartimaeus cried the louder, "Jesus, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me." And because of that desperation, Jesus reached out and touched him and he healed him. The great hymn writer Fanny Crosby, who was blind from birth, she was reading that story of Bartimaeus one night before she retired for the evening. And according to her own testimony, she had this horrible dream. She was sitting by the roadside and Jesus was passing by. And he was calling others by name and they were following him. And he passed right by Fanny Crosby and did not mention her name. She got up the next morning after having had that dream, sat down and wrote the words, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by." See, friend, that's the desperation that Jesus is pointing out here. Friend, I can't change what the Word says here. Strive to enter through the narrow gate. He didn't say just flippantly raise a hand or nonchalantly repeat a prayer or just with no emphasis on the way you live, just join a church. Now, I may lose my audience after this sermon today. But friend, this is what Jesus says. And I want to tell you, there has never been anyone who desperately wanted to know Jesus who couldn't. And when we ever get to the place in life where our desperation factor exceeds our embarrassment factor, we will be candidates for the grace of God. God's looking for people who are desperate to know Him and to follow Him. But then we see a second thing. Not only is it a serious way, it's a singular way. It's a door. Not many doors. One door. And it's a narrow door. Now, maybe someone's in the audience today and you're thinking, you know, Jesus probably just had a bad day and he just blurted something out here that was contrary to what his normal teaching was about salvation. If that's what you think again. Because Jesus said in Matthew 7, 13 and 14, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. There are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it." Exclamation point. That ends the discussion. That's what Jesus said. Why are many on the broad road and few on the narrow road? Because to be on the narrow road, you got to put yourself in a position of humility and admit your need. Friend, if this is a narrow door, you know what that means? It's a tight fit. And if it's a tight fit, we got to remove some baggage. We got to remove the baggage of our self-sufficiency and our arrogance and our pride. Think there's something we can do to gain His approval. Is All you can do is come to me and admit your need. Admit your need. It's a tight fit. No one has ever been saved by giving up enough sin. Did you hear that? Say amen. No one has ever been saved by giving up enough sin. But no one has ever been saved who came to Jesus without a desire and a willingness to turn away from sin. That is called repentance. Repentance. What's this door? This door is Jesus. But friend, we go through this narrow door the way Jesus says go, or we don't go. It's a singular way. But not only do we see the way of salvation, we see the warning of salvation very quickly. The warning of salvation down in verses 25 through 30. And my, oh my, what a warning this is. And I tell you, when we begin to see what Jesus is saying here, no wonder we have to be so serious about making sure that we've come through the narrow door and that we are on the narrow way. Jesus gives a threefold warning. Number one, the time element. The time element. Verse 24, strive to enter the narrow gate, for many, I say to you, they will seek to enter, but they will not be able. How this assaults our complacency when it comes to making sure that we are on the narrow way by coming through the narrow door. See, there's a time limit to the offer of salvation. Did you know that we don't get saved anytime we want to get saved? Doesn't happen like that. There is a time limit to the offer. See, the gate is open now. Right now this morning, right now today, the gate is open. But it might not be open this afternoon. It might not be open tomorrow. And friend, I don't tell you that to try to manipulate you to make, quote, some kind of a decision. I tell you that because that is the truth. And right here, right now, you can respond if you wish, but I can't guarantee you that you can this afternoon or tonight or tomorrow. Friend, I'm here to tell you, with all the love in my heart, when your body is gone, so is your opportunity. Once you're outside of the body, there is no other opportunity that is given. So when death comes or when Jesus comes, the door is slammed shut. And when that door is slammed shut, nobody has the authority to pry open that door. What a warning. What a warning. Every unsaved person, you might say, is living on borrowed time. And the time to be saved is the time when the Holy Spirit shows us our need to be saved. That's the time to be saved. It's not to wait till tomorrow, the next day, next week, next year. Because we're all living as unsaved people on borrowed time. So the moment the Spirit of God speaks to your heart, come to Him. Come through that narrow door and begin to follow Jesus. So there's the time element. But there's also the relational element. The relational element. Down in verse 25, the C part of that verse, Jesus said, I will say to those, I do not know you, where you are from. Then you will begin to say, we ate and we drank in your presence. You taught in our streets, but he will say, I tell you, I do not know you, where you are from. So depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity. Listen, salvation is not familiarity with Christ. They said, you've taught in our streets. We've hung around you. We've been where you are. We are familiar with you. And Jesus said, but I'll say, depart from me, you evildoers, because I do not know you. Friend, Jesus teaches that not even being engaged in ministry is salvation. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Salvation is not just being familiar with the name Jesus. It is not even being engaged in ministry for Jesus. Salvation is a shared life with Jesus. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Salvation is the shared life of Christ. It's Christ living in us. So the burning question of the hour is, do I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? See, that's salvation. Then there's the transformation element. Down in verse 27, the C part of that verse, notice what he says. He says, I will say to you, to those of you I don't have a relationship with, I will say to you, depart from me, all of you workers of iniquity. Please listen carefully. Have I been through the narrow door? Does the life of Christ live in me to the degree that it has transformed me and translated me from the category of being an evil doer? Is there authentic, practical righteousness in my life? Not sinless perfection, but is the norm of my life on a daily basis to pursue righteousness and to live righteously? Jesus said that's what it's all about. And so that leads us in closing to two very quick things. Number one, a personal examination down in verses 28 through 30. Now, I want you to look at these verses. I want to read them again for emphasis' sake. Jesus said there's going to be weeping, gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all of the prophets in the kingdom of God, and you yourself, you've been thrust out. Now, I don't know of any way to put a smiley face on those verses. That's serious stuff. Weeping, wailing, gnashing of teeth. I think that one of the greatest horrors of hell will be to see who is in the other place and knowing I could have been there. And I heard what Jesus said about the narrow way, but I said, I'm not going to go that far. I don't want to be that radical. How close I was back then, but now how far away that I am. And he said to these Jews, you know, you think you're first, but in reality, you're going to be last. There's going to be a lot of folks there that you thought never would have been there. The Gentiles, they never expected them to be there, but Jesus said they would be. Why? Because they came through the narrow door. They yielded and submitted themselves to his lordship. Friend, I want to tell you, contrary to public opinion, those who make it are those who humble themselves before God and plead for mercy and grace. They put absolutely no stock in deserving salvation based on their own merits. You ever seen yourself like that before? I'm telling you, I haven't. It'll rock your world. When you finally realize, God, there's not enough good stuff I can do. There aren't enough churches I can join. There aren't enough baptistries to dunk me. God, I am in such desperate need for grace and mercy. That's what I'm asking for. That's the heart Jesus is looking for. Not some puffed up, proud, look at me what I've done, I deserve it. That's the teaching of Jesus about the narrow way. So we need to think about eternity, but we also need to think about the Scripture. Think about the Scripture. Friend, I want to tell you, Jesus taught this. I don't care what anyone says. What I preach this morning is right. It's right because Jesus said it. Jesus is the final authority. Jesus says it's a narrow door. It's not a broad door, it's a narrow door. And when you come through the narrow door, it's a narrow way. How can we know if we are on that narrow way? How can we know it? Let me give you a verse, and then I'm going to read some verses in closing. 1 John 5:13, the Bible says, "These things have I written unto you, who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have everlasting life." How do we know it? John said, "These things have I written to you." What were the "these things"? The book of 1 John. And the book of 1 John, he says, this is how you know if you've come through the narrow door. 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. "Now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He who says, 'I know him,' and he does not keep his commandments is a liar. The truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself to walk even as he walked." How did Jesus walk? Two ways: obedience and faith. Study the New Testament. He obeyed his Father's commands. He lived by faith. Now, I don't need to explain those verses. We just need to believe those verses. He who says he is in him, but does not, never, has no concern about keeping his commandments, is a liar, and the truth's not in him. Chapter 3, verse 6. "Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor knows him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God." Preacher, you have really messed me up now. I know I've been saved, but I know I still have struggles with sin. Who doesn't? We still live in a body of flesh. But the verb tense here is, this person who is saved does not consistently practice unrighteous living. He can't. He can't, because God's seed, that's the Holy Spirit, that's the life of Christ, lives in him. I want to tell you, there are a whole lot of times I sin, but every time I do, I am convicted, convicted, convicted. And every time I do, I don't want to go back to that. Do you? If we can sin with a high hand and not even think about it, and it never bothers us, I'm telling you, friend, you're on the broad road if I'm talking about you. We can't do it. Verse number 10. "In this the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God. Now, friend, we just need to believe those words. Verses 14 and 15. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Chapter 4, verse 7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this the love of God was manifest toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, then we ought also to love one another. And then verse 19, we love him because he first loved us. When we walk through the narrow door, there is a love for God that is put in our hearts. Perhaps love for God and love for God's Christ are the two greatest assurances that we know him. Friend, I know I've hit you with some heavy stuff. What is salvation? It's a narrow door that leads to a narrow way. But you want to know what the good news is? That narrow door is wide open to anybody that wants to walk through it. But this door is not broad. It is not wide. It is narrow. We come through that narrow door. Who is Jesus? The way he says, come. We cannot change the invitation. Would you stand, please? Heads are bowed and eyes closed. And Father, oh, how I pray in Jesus' mighty name that we would indeed think seriously about the words from the Master that we have heard today. And God, I pray if anyone is here today who wants to come through this narrow door, they will see it is open to them. It truly is. And they can come. They can come just as they are, all the while knowing Jesus is not going to leave them the way that they are. And there would be this desire for repentance and faith in Jesus. It changes lives and not simply becomes a church member. Oh God, I pray that we would see you work mightily in the hearts and lives of people today. Oh God, I don't want to be one of those who think I'm first but will end up last. Oh God, I pray for people who need to humble themselves before you today and cry out for mercy and grace, that they would do so in Jesus' name. Oh God, I pray that we would be committed to sharing the whole counsel of God, the true gospel, the one that truly works, takes people like they are, but radically changes them. So Father, I pray that no one here today would allow pride or embarrassment or anything else that Satan has put in us an obstacle in front of the door of salvation. May they not allow those things to steal from them the joy that could be theirs today. God, I pray for those that you have led to be a part of this church family who need to unite with us today, those who need to come forward and follow in believers' baptism, or those who just need to pray. We pray that, God, you would be glorified during this invitation that we extend from you today to people. In Jesus' name I pray. Heads are bowed and eyes are